source, mostly on CF Engine for about 6 years. I feel extremely privileged working open source. It lets me hack around on stuff like this for a paycheck all day. Some of the stuff that I do, so I use org mode pretty much all of the time. I sit inside of my text editor, and it keeps eating more and more of my life, which I like. I have a background in systems administration, but I do a little bit of everything. I do a little bit of C code, I do CF Engine policy, Perl, Python, Shell, SQL, Ruby. I have to touch all of these things throughout the course of the day to patch something here or there. I work with customers, mostly, but I also work very closely with developers and business people. So I am making presentations, writing documents, writing reports, emails, a whole bunch of texts that I end up wrangling. And I end up doing pretty much everything inside org mode. So what is org mode? It's been around since 2003. It is a markup language, yes. Kind of like Markdown, maybe slightly more complicated than Markdown, but way better in the end. It is best supported in Emacs, but it's not required that you use Emacs to start using org mode. It's a system for managing plain text, and it's a place where I can just write everything down to remember everything so that I don't have that sitting around up inside of my head. Anytime I have a little random idea of something I want to remember, it's just a quick keystroke, and then I save a note, and I have that recorded somewhere to review later. For non-Emacs users, first of all here, like starting off with an editor work. Who's using Emacs? One user. Great. Who's using Vim? Nearly everyone else. And what else are you using? If you're not using Vim or Emacs?
Nano?
Atom?
Sublime?
VS Code? VS Code user, a couple of them? Okay. So, there's some options. There is a couple things for Vim that can give you some of the functionality that you get inside of org mode. Sublime Text, Atom has a grammar for syntax and making things a little bit nicer. But really, to get the full power of org mode, you kind of need everything else that Emacs has. So much so that it's completely blurred for me between, what is really org mode specific, and then what are these other Emacs things that kind of just leak into my workflow because I don't have to leave this mini operating system anymore. I am a Vim user. I identify as a Vim user. I'm going to open a text file. I will type Vim. I can't manage to type inside a document without leaving a string of colons and WQs and stuff like that. So I managed to become a full-time Emacs user because of SpaceMax, where Emo mode comes pre-configured, and it's easy to set a bunch of other things up. Took me several attempts for org mode to actually get its hooks in fully. I think the first time that I learned about org mode was probably in 2005, and it was great, but I couldn't figure out how to quit Emacs. And then just bouncing back and forth between everything else that I was doing and then this window that I had no idea how to control, it didn't stick very well. I refound it again a couple of years later, and I worked really hard to learn just enough Emacs to manage to use org mode. So it was my note-taking application, and then I did everything else in Vim, in terminals and everywhere else, and I just got my notes over here. But after a few more years of perseverance, I ended up getting evil mode working before I ever found SpaceMax. And once I found SpaceMax, things just snowballed and went really quickly. It just made dealing with Emacs so much easier. Highly recommend you give it a shot. So, org mode can be used as a task manager or as a planner, authoring and outlining documents. I built this presentation in org mode. Reveal.js. Used for keeping notes, maintaining to-do lists, planning projects. See, I do my email inside of org mode. I do Jira inside of org mode. I keep secrets inside of org mode. I keep notes. I clock all of my time. What else do I do in here? I manage contacts. I do tables and spreadsheets inside of org mode. I do it on my tablet and on my mobile phone. And these things all synchronize back together. Keep a work log, the things that I'm working on, have highly detailed notes. Has anybody ever heard of the term literate programming? Anybody familiar with McDonald Knuth? Couple, okay. The idea there is that your focus is the prose, and then you will intersperse some other things. So I use some of this same methodology when I'm doing sysadmin related tasks. I need to run this command on this other server. Well, I don't open a terminal anymore and then go run a command and then copy the code, the stuff from the terminal, and then paste it back in my notes. That takes way too long for most things. I'll just type the command inside the little box and then I'll hit a keystroke and that command will go run on a remote server and then the results get pulled right back inside of my document, which is great for then handing off to somebody else. I mentioned that I use Jira. Jira's markup is, I think, is terrible. And most of the time when I read tickets inside of Jira and things like that, comments, descriptions, they're all terrible. Nobody uses the markup. It's terrible. But since I can type it all in Word mode and I can export it to Jira syntax, my comments look amazing. All hyperlinks are linked. I can have colors. I can have tables all nicely inside of my Jira comments. And I don't even have to actually visit stupid Jira website to do that. So these are a bunch of the things that I do. This is kind of a choose your, I'm going to abandon this Reveal.js presentation because it looks really cool. Let's see here. Can't see that. Anyway, it looks cool. It's slick, but it's not the same as just using org mode. So I'm going to switch to just using org mode because that will be so much easier to convince you that you should also use org mode. Let's see here. So, some of the things that I do. So it's kind of a choose your own adventure. What do you find interesting?
Okay.
Yes.
Hate
you. See here.
I hate me for having gas. See. Very much.
And. Whoa. Is that better?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. This is I can't see my whole thing here, so that's. Is there a? I'm not sure how to move the screen over. Let me see here. Well, that's
not. You can probably go into your display settings and like shift it over a little bit.
I just think it's probably a little small.
Yeah, just kind of tumble over. There we go. I can just clone it because I don't need to have speaker notes on the side anymore. Alright. So, I listed off a whole bunch of random things that I do. I have notes on a bunch of kind of subcategories of things that I do. I guess, what do you guys think is interesting? Thanks for me. You know, where I would probably start here is up here at this literate star offing. I don't know about how you all feel. I personally hate the term DevOps. It's just rife with confusion within the industry if it's people sitting around holding hands or whatever. However, you know, the goals of the stuff that's under the umbrella is how we should be working, I think. So I spend my day mostly inside of org mode. One of the things that's really great about board mode is this capturing system. So when I have a note, a to-do, or a support request, or something like that that's a frequently recurring thing, I can capture this thing, and then I can use these templates for these commonly recurring things. So you can see here, I have some capture templates for just random to-dos, for support cases, for Jira tickets, for responding to email, adding new contacts. I do daily review, kind of look back and see what I did over the day, create a summary for tomorrow, you know, the next day's stand-up. And then I have a whole bunch of other templates that are specific to different kinds of meetings. The nice thing about board capture is that if I'm sitting there and working on something and then some interruption comes that I need to do, I can run board capture and quickly grab a note and save it, but I don't have to spend time doing that. It's an instant thing, and then I can stay on my focus. I have a plan to go through this, so I do need some feedback for what kind of things would you like to see with your workflow and your organizing of information? What kind of things would you like to keep track of?
Email.
Alright, let's see here. So, I use, there's a couple of different email options. So as far as org mode is concerned, there is this org mine package, and it's got some functions in there that allow me to HTMLize my org mode buffers. So I have my org syntax, I type up the email that I'm going to send, and then I run this function that takes that, converts it into a multi-part, one plain text, one HTML email, and then I send that off. I send that off to my local postfix server relay so that I have offline mail sending so that I can send email when I'm not connected to the internet and it will be queued and actually sent later. I use MVSync to mirror my iMac mail locally, and I use MU for E to read the email and access the email inside of Emacs. There's also another package called NotMuch. There's GNUs, there's Wunderlist, there's some other Emacs email related packages. They're not really specific to org mode, but one of the things that I do in org mode when I'm reading my email, let's see. Switch over to email and then search for KLF. Oh, I've got an email here from Joel and he says the schedule has been posted and I'm going to say, okay, well, I want to capture this text that I have selected because I'm going to respond to Joel later and let him know that I still plan on being here. And so I'm going to use my email response capture. Now this has created a to-do, so this is org capture, and it has popped up. It took the text that I had selected, put it inside of a quote block, and I'm going to capture this to-do into my main org file that I need to respond to this. So then usually what I would do, let's see here, I'll set, this is already scheduled for today, so I'll just finish that capture. Now it's been captured, I didn't spend a whole lot of time thinking about that. Later on in the day, I need to come back, oh, I need to respond to Joel, how do I know I need to do that? I look at my org agenda, this is part of the to-do system, and you can see right here, I have a to-do task with the priority of B to respond to Joel. So I'll come down here, I'll hop over to that spot in my work file, just a text file. And being a bin user, I have not managed to treat all of my org files as a data store. I still treat them like text files because I'm a bin user and I think about them as text files. If you're new to it, I would recommend that you focus more on agenda mode and some of the crazy abilities that org has. You can have these to-dos in all kinds of different files. So I work with a bunch of different customers, which means that I have my data for each customer segmented into its own place, but all of those to-dos across all of those files get pulled up into this single agenda. So I can see what's going on from any of these crazy places, because I am not an organized person, naturally. Org mode helps me compensate for the fact that I am not organized. It just lets me find all of the information really quickly. Alright, so back to this email. I have this this email here. I'm getting distracted by some of these notes that I took from the other sessions earlier. So I'm going to narrow to this subtree, get rid of all the other stuff out of my way so that I can focus on responding to this email. And I'll come in here and I'll say, okay, thanks. And I'm just gonna take this text here, yank it. I just hit enter on that link at the top, which took me straight back into my email to that message where I can now reply to all. And then I can just paste what I wanted to say, yank out what he had before, and then this is where I make it pretty by writing org mime HTMLize, which constructs the multi-part mime message, and then I'll apologize to him later for this fabulous email that I just sent. So that's how you email with org mode. What else is interesting? Task management. It's going to say, man, we are in trouble if email is the most interesting thing in our lives. All right, let's look at this. Okay, so you know how to hit a weak spot. Oh, I guess maybe you haven't noticed. Maybe you have noticed as I'm hopping around in this file. This is just a plain text file. I can cat it and show it to you. But these nodes, they start with an asterisk. So each asterisk represents the number of headline levels. So one asterisk, you're the top headline. And then it's a hierarchical file. And you probably saw that this stuff was folding. That's just part of the nice things in org mode when dealing with outlines. I can also move these things around. I'm going to move these tasks up and down. And it doesn't just move that one. It also moves all of those subtasks with it. So I can all, you know, move these trees around into whatever order I want. All right, so back to task management. Toggle image display.
Reminding me that, hey,
these are the things that are on the agenda. You know, what you're working on may or may not be important, but maybe you should put it on the agenda, maybe you should use the agenda. So I highly recommend that. It looks like it doesn't show the animation when I'm viewing this file. It's kind of great that I can see the images directly in the window text editor, but it doesn't show rendered GIFs. With the agenda and to-do task management. So you can do things like set deadlines, set schedules. I mentioned that I clock my time. And in relation to clocking time, do I have any? I guess I can just do it right here. Clocking. So when I run clock in, it just puts a little timestamp here with when I started clocking this task. And with my org capture templates that we briefly saw earlier, those capture templates automatically start clocking when that capture opens up. So it's timestamped, and while I'm taking the note, it's capturing and logging that time. And then as soon as I finish the capture, it resumes the clock back wherever I was clocking time before. So I can automatically keep track of all of those context switches and how much time I'm spending on every little thing. Let's see here. We're about to use. Okay. So, in the agenda. So, here we go. Let me see if I can tag this. No export. So, you can tag entries. Then you can use tags. You can also use properties to then find and sift through your entries. So, I can have. Certain tags have special meaning, so I exported this presentation to Reveal.js and a nice HTML thing at the beginning. If I have this no export tag attached to a headline, I will have that in my org source, but then when I export it, it won't be there. So it's hidden then from sharing it with other people, which is handy. But you could also tag these with all kinds of other information, right? Like at home or at work or some other type of context that you're going to want to look up that's contextual to. Then you can search by the to-do states, by the tags. There's a couple of other cool packages here. So the agenda mode allows you to search for anything that becomes part of your agenda. So if you have these org files all strewn across your file system, you need to set up, you know, let org know which files you want to be part of your agenda. So I've struggled a lot with like managing the volume of text that I have because when I'm doing sysadmin type tasks in org mode and I'm running these remote commands, I can sometimes end up with really big command output that is then shoved inside of this buffer array. I found that when an individual text file grows to about 3 megabytes, things start to slow down, and I think it's just because I tend to have some long horizontal lines, which Emacs kind of struggles with. But anyway, so there's a couple of these things for searching. Org rifle is one of them, so I can do agenda rifle. So then I can search my org files. How well is it going to be able to see KLF? So then it searches my org files, and I can see that, let's see, I'm supposed to respond to Joel. I didn't mark that as done. It came up here. Somebody suggested to ship something as an appliance. I was giving a lightning talk yesterday, and then I'm supposed to email this presentation to Paul. Because he couldn't be here. And he needs to be able to make reproducible research. And because I keep talking about these code blocks, so I'm just going to move to that. Because I can execute these code blocks inside of org mode, I had suggested to him something for research students to do. Write your whole thesis document, and you can run some code. You can run some Python, you can run some Shell, you can run some R, and the outputs for each one of these things can then be fed into another block of code and transformed, and then you can export beautiful PDFs with math equations, which, you know, people like. All right, so Got an example here. Pull this out to here. All right. So one of the things I do, I work on CF Engine. It's an automation thing. And compliance thing. A lot of what I do is small individual examples or looking at somebody else's policy and being like, oh, I have problems here. Fix it. Let me simplify this down into something very easy to understand and share with you. So I extended Org Babel to be able to support CF Engine a couple of years ago. It was 2017, I think, when I published that. And it has been one of the greatest time savers for me, over like 30 seconds off of every single CF Engine example I do, and lots. So you can see here, this is just a fragment of CF Engine policy. Kind of hard to see, maybe. But here it says begin source CF Engine 3, that's the language. And this language type has some special options, like include the standard lib. So it automatically includes some commonly used stuff so that it doesn't have to make the examples longer. Sets log level, sets export to both. So when I export this, I want to export the rendered version of the source code block, but also I want to export the results of the execution of this block. And then there's this other option here, run with main true. So this is, like I said, just a fragment, and it wraps this fragment inside a bundle to make it something that can actually be run. So if I simply comma comma or control C C, I don't know what the Emacs one is. I use comma comma to execute this code block, and then it asks you down here at the bottom, evaluate the CF Engine 3 code block on your system. Yes or no? I'll say yes. Yes. And then we can see that immediately there underneath, CF Engine says hello world, and I can just come up in here and I can edit this code block. And let's also make it say the version and the date. And I'll run that again. And then immediately in the results, I have the other stuff. So this makes it super fast for me to prototype things for people. Of course, I love CF Engine, but you might like something different, like Python. So if I look at this Python code, so the reason why I'm hopping in, all right, so I've got this block over here. This is an org source block, and it's got commas in front of the special stuff. That's because I needed to embed org mode syntax in an org mode file so that I could export it and it would show you what it was supposed to look like. So I can pop out from this block into this major mode where I'm editing now inside of org, and then I'm just gonna grab the Python source block so that I can run it from inside work mode. So this hopping around bit is simply because I had invented it for a presentation. So got some Python here. I can run it. Python says hello world. It's executed with Python. I don't know any Python options. Somebody know what I would add to that to print the version? No? Okay. It's not that interesting anyway. Nobody likes Python. Everybody likes Shell. So we can do shell. Let's see here. Shell says hello world. Can't tell you what shell I need. So there's all kinds of different languages support. So you mentioned Jupyter Notebook. Org mode's way cooler than Jupyter Notebook because you've got so many other language options, and you can export it to other things like a Reveal.js.
You can also export Jupyter Notebook
to Jira. Okay. You export to Jira. Oh. Okay. Alright, so there's a little bit on code blocks. Let's see here. So you can reuse these results from what I have in here. Alright, so what we see here is a shell block, which is using the output from the CF Engine block from before, so that I can print that back out. So I can use, you know, one language to do one bit of processing and produce a together. It's very handy for that. You can also mark code blocks as cached, right? So if you have this dependency, this block is the output of this one, you can say, hey, this block is cached, so that when you regenerate the result of this, it doesn't trigger the rerun of the other block, which is super important if you have, you know, long-running code times, or if you're waiting on batch execution jobs to finish where you're pulling your data from, and things like that. Let's see here. Oh, did I mention remote execution? I hope I did. Not, I will. I use SQL too to do database stuff sometimes. So here's an example of where I have a SQL block. Select the first report timestamp from some table, limit it to one, and I'm going to use a Postgres connection to a CFDB database, but not until after I SSH to this host. So this block SSHs to the host with the credential specified in the header, and then uses Postgres to run that query, and then gives me the results back in that nice table. And tables can be used as input to other blocks as well. Let's see here, code blocks. Oh, diagrams. I do diagrams in org mode also. So this is plant UML. It's a diagram of CFEngine's pulse execution sequence. This is what the source looks like. So it's great, right? You can manage your stuff in plain text as opposed to, like, I don't know, opening some GUI thing and clicking the mouse, and I don't know, that's terrible work for me. I find it so much more gratifying to be able to make a little change and then commit that to a GitHub repo, and then everything automatically regenerates, and it's all great. So let's see here, diagram, code blocks, literate programming. So I mentioned this before, Donald News kind of pioneered this idea of literate programming and tangling things together. So this presentation is a literate programming thing, kind of. I've got some other examples. I don't know if you're familiar with literate programming. I can't remember if I asked. Somewhat. So the idea is that the prose is the focus, right? And you have these code blocks, like, oh, I need to have a function that starts the execution of my program. Source block, main, right? The focus is the intention in the text, not the program. So these source blocks, I've just been executing them directly in line. That's usually what I do with it. But these source blocks can be tangled out into separate files. So you can have your org file here with your document and all the stuff, and you run this org tangle, and all of these source blocks get pulled out into just their own sources. So let me see here. I can probably just make one of those. Come up here. Here we go. I'll take this shell here. I'll add tangle, temp, example.sh, narrow here. Oh, that's not where I want it to be. Narrow. Okay, so then I'll tangle that. Vowel tangle. And then over here, the example.sh that was tangled from that org document. This is fun stuff. All right, let me widen this back out and see where we are. All right, so we talked about work log a little bit here, and literate ops, about capturing, time tracking. I showed you, 10 minutes. Showed you how I clock my time. This is in dark mode. This presentation is available on GitHub. So if you want to better see some of these things that are dark, Let me know, I can get you the URL. But this is an example that shows a clock report for a day. So I can see that I clocked 7.5 hours of like active time working on stuff. And then it's got this idle timeout thing. If I stop working in my buffer, it prompts me, it's like, hey, are you still working? Do you want to continue this clock or end this clock? What do you want to do with this idle time on your clock? You can subtract from it or add to it, things like that. So it's really nice when I walk away from my desk, go get a drink, and then that thing that was going to take 2 minutes ended up taking, you know, an hour because I got sidetracked with a kid or something. I walk back to my desk and it says, oh, what are you going to do? This is idle time. I'm like, kill it. Don't clock that time when I wasn't here. And then it just fixes my clocks. Talk about Jira. Let me see this. Switch back to this presentation and see if checklist, time tracking. I don't know if you're going to be able to see it or not because it's so dark. All right, well, I'll just tell you what it's doing. Over here, I'm managing Jira from inside of org mode, right? So I had some issue that I came across that I needed to fix. So I type my notes, and then here I've got the issue that I'm editing. So I went in, I typed a comment, I added some markup, and then I updated the comment. And I did all of that inside of org mode. I never left. And then over here, I just hit refresh to show you a beautiful comment that was, you know, marked up nicely. And it looked like somebody spent some time instead of rushing through and just filling out some notes. So, sorry, dark color scheme. I'm tracking Jira. Some things that are, I guess, less specific to org mode. Screencast. That's kind of what happened. Oh, I made Emacs. Well, I use GPG for stuff, So here we can see, well, this dark screencast here, you won't be able to see what that's doing, so I'll just do it here. Headlines that are tagged with crypt will get encrypted with my GPG key just for me. So here I can decrypt this and see what the secret is. Decrypt or encrypt entry. Type my password for GPG, and then you can see the secret stuff that's there. And then when I save the file, it's automatically re-encrypted. What else? We've got like less than 5 minutes. Anything here that's interesting we haven't talked about?
So like web archiving, do you ever need to like disable the impact of Stack Overflow or something like that?
That's a great one. In fact, last night I was just looking at that and adding that to this. There's this web archiving. I was needing to look up older something about that, so I was fishing through that. There's a couple packages for that. Ord Web Tools is really cool. So if I do, if I search, I'll use Google, and I'll search for older physics radius. And find him here. Okay, I've got this page. So I'm going to grab this, the URL for the page. Copy URL. And then I'm going to switch back over here to my presentation. All right, so talking about web archiving, right? So I need to do this Ord Web Tools. I'll just do insert web page as entry. So I'm going to grab this web page, convert it into Ord, and stuff it straight into my notes. And there it is. So now I have an Ord version of the website on WSU pulled straight into my notes. There's another package, OrgBoard, which will take like a, I think it uses wget or curl or something. It makes a tar archive. And then you have a fully browsable offline version of your bookmark page, which is super cool. So how many people have I convinced to use OrgMode? One. Two. That's really good. You can give it a shot. Awesome. Yeah, it's not something you're gonna learn like overnight. It's one of those things where things just keep piling on, and the more you start doing, the further you can get. Like I said, for me, executing CF engine code inside of Ord mode, like they was the last thing that I needed to be able to stay inside of Ord mode most of the time. And then the next thing after that was email. So that was the next thing that I worked on after that. Going mobile, that's important these days. I know that I'm running out of time. Oh, and tables and spreadsheets. So much. There's a bunch of options. I use OrgSleep, which is an Android app, and I use SyncThing to synchronize around a directory full of Ord files. In my experience, I have found that I use one input file per device, just because sometimes the sync will lag if something isn't working. So I have one file for my tablet, one file for my phone, and I capture things there, and then when I come back to my computer, I will grab them off of from those files and then refile them where they need to be, and things are great. And it works pretty well. It's been working here all weekend, like on unpredictable networks, and it's been syncing between all of them pretty well. Quickly, I guess I can show you the same. You can do tables and like spreadsheets inside of Ord mode, which is super exciting. You can move things around and treat it just like a crazy spreadsheet, and you can do calculations. Blogging. Who uses WordPress? None of you? Good job. You can do that from Ord mode if you want. I use Hugo, and there's a couple exporters that will export to Hugo. There's like an easy Hugo thing. I don't use any of that because Hugo supports Ord natively, not very well, but well enough that I don't have to mess around with like exporting blog posts and everything. I just save them in Ord and let Hugo render that. And then like GitHub host them. Blogging, journaling. I mentioned journaling the other day. Presentations, task management, calendaring, table, spreadsheets. I think I hit most of the stuff. Anything that you want to do that I haven't mentioned, what would you like to do inside of your editor?
How does it pop up reminders?
How does it pop up reminders? There are a couple of different packages for that. You can integrate it with, there's some calendaring integration, stuff like that, so you can integrate it with your Google Calendar or your whatever other calendars. And there is, there are a couple of different options for integrating in notifications, like inside of Emacs, or then like to something on your desktop, like what, Gitter. I can't remember any names of. I have all notifications off for the most part, so I don't know a lot about notifications. I try to keep it to a minimum. But there are several different packages, and whatever the standard desktop notification thing is can be wired in to let you know of tasks that you have that are coming due and things like that. Anything else you'd like to do inside of your editor?
Could you, for the tables, could you have them reference other Word files? Like, could you just make a calendar out of the table and then just click on the dates and it'll just take you to a different Word file?
You could do that if you wanted to build that with a table or something, but you could also just use the calendaring that's built inside Word mode. So here's the little calendar thing. It's kind of hard to see. All the bright red days are days where I have journal entries, and I'm not brave enough to just open my journal and see what I wrote for a random day. But you can do that too. That's what I do. There's also a thing called date tree. So for me, I find it works really well to have one file per day. Other people like to have a whole bunch of entries in a single file, and there's a date tree for that, which will log it into a headline structure by the day, so year, month, day, and then it's all in. And then there's a reverse date tree, which will put the entries, the newest entries, at the top of the file, which Gmail users like. What else would you like to do inside of your editor? That's it? All right, I think I'm out of time. Thanks for coming.
You might not have access to everything.
Right.
But yeah, yeah.